Welcome to a new season of Asian American Life. I'm your host, Ernabelle DeMillo. Let's start with some exciting news. Award-winning journalist Vivian Lee has joined us as a correspondent. You'll hear from her shortly. Asian American Life turns 10 this season, so it's only fitting that we pay tribute to legendary photographer Corky Lee. Corky has been featured many times on our show, including his photography. He spent his life documenting the lives of Asian Americans. Sadly, he passed away last year. But as you can see in this exhibit inside a courthouse in Brooklyn, his legacy lives on.
A courthouse is where one seeks justice, so it's only fitting it's the location for the exhibit Photographic Justice, a tribute to Corky Lee. Some of his most iconic photos are on display here. He used to say his camera was like a sword to fight racial injustice. The exhibit also includes works from some 30 photographers who pay homage to the man they called a friend and mentor. Lee spent most of his life covering the AAPI community, and he will always be remembered as the undisputed, unofficial Asian American photographer laureate.
Now, here's what's on our show.
Pride and Perseverance, author Alvin Eng's memoir on Our Laundry, Our Town. Graying Gracefully, Why Are Women Embracing Their Roots? Plus, Asian Americans speak out against social injustice in Free Chol Soo Lee. The Art of Kicking, meet the family of taekwondo champions. And we visit New York's Burmese community. This and more on Asian American Life.
The history of the Chinese laundry workers is a part of U.S. history, and it's that story that author, performer, and activist Alvin Eng writes about in his new memoir.
This is key to New York City labor, too. This is really the New York City labor movement. This is an amazing moment.
The newest exhibit at the Museum of the City of New York was the perfect backdrop for my interview with Alvin Eng. Activism New York now features a section on the Chinese American laundry workers who fought against racism and for labor rights.
And I'm so glad that they are really putting a spotlight on the Chinese hand laundry lines, because it was like not just for the community, but it was almost like the first Chinese American, Asian American labor action in America.
He credits the alliance for paving the way for his family. His parents owned and operated the Fu J Chin Chinese hand laundry from 1947 to 1977, and it's the setting of his new book, Our Laundry, Our Town, My Chinese American Life from Flushing to the Downtown Stage and Beyond.
People would routinely open the door and take pot shots like, can you speak English, Charlie? No tiki, no shirty. Dad would take one for the family and grow sullen and speechless.
What inspired you to finally put all of this to paper, your story about your life?
I guess you could say in the short term, after years and years of touring, it was time to make an album.
Eng, who is also a musician, likes to use rock and roll analogies when talking about his life. And it's his life that many people are now talking about, thanks to his new book, an intimate portrait of his childhood and beyond.
Every day I'd go home, not just to a family that was rooted in a different culture, but because my parents had an arranged marriage, it was like going back to a household that was rooted in a different century.
Their life was also rooted in secrets. The Chinese Exclusion Act made it nearly impossible for the Chinese to move to America. So his father, like many others, became a paper son, a term used to describe someone who uses papers claiming false U.S. citizenship or blood ties.
We thought it was just more of a cultural thing. We realized, a lot of Chinese, probably Filipinos too, why are we so shy? Why do we only socialize with people in our circle? And then you realize that's not a cultural thing. It was a legal thing. Growing up under the guise, if you will, or the cloud of the Chinese Exclusion Act, they had to live this under-the-radar existence. They only socialized in safe circles.
There were other secrets, too. His parents fighting, his dad beating his mom disappearing for stretches at a time.
When you're very young and you see your parents fighting, many ways that led me to always seek alternative worlds. And that I get first led me to drawing pictures and ultimately led to me writing. And I could not deal with that violence.
Eng, the youngest of five children, also found solace in American TV, rock and roll, and eventually the downtown punk rock scene.
Punk rock in particular, because I mean, I guess finally after really trying my whole life at that point, like to cover my otherness, and all of a sudden in the punk rock community, said, no, we are going to feature our otherness. We're going to scream our otherness, our outsideness to the rooftops. So it became, oh my God, this is a great place to do that.
While punk rock helped him appreciate his otherness, it was theater where he found himself. Eng became a playwright, writing numerous plays, including his autobiographical monologue, The Last Emperor of Flushing, which he performed in his ancestral home in Guangzhou, China. The young boy from Queens found his voice, and today he's not afraid to use it. Along with his writings and performances, he and his wife advocate for Asian Americans and artistic freedom. He hopes his memoir will inspire others to do the same.
Activism on the streets and the activism through the arts. Just something really making your voice heard. I think that's the greatest message we can find, like making your voice heard in a way that you want it to be. I think that's the strongest takeaway message that someone can take away from this book.
I'm Ernabelle DeMillo for Asian American Life.
I'm Vivian Lee. At the start of the pandemic, with a lot of salons shuttering, many women had no choice but to let their gray hair show. They couldn't get their roots covered. Now, 2 years later, even with salons opened again, many women are opting not to go back. This is a trend that's literally growing.
From celebrities on the red carpet to everyday women calling themselves graceful, going gray out loud and proud is one result of the pandemic. New York City theater manager Rubina Shafi says it gave her time to reflect and experiment just as she turned 50.
So I started doing things like the silver spray in my hair just to see if I could pull it off, and went through a lot of really ugly stages. I was platinum blonde for a while by accident.
After years of posting her graying journey during the pandemic as Mercury Streaks, she is staying gray.
I must say, I feel super liberated by it. Just the time save, not just in coloring or making appointments, but also just the worrying every day, like, oh my God, do I have any roots showing?
A woman could spend thousands a year on salon treatments to cover her grays, but Shafi values even more what she's gained.
What this did for me was liberate me from 50. From what I thought 50 was supposed to be, or 50 was an end to something.
No small statement there, since human civilization has valued youth over age for millennia. From the Epic of Gilgamesh thousands of years ago, through Chinese, Indian, and European myths of a fountain of youth, increasing lifespans means more years living with gray hair, though that varies by race. A 2021 report by the Journal of Clinical and Aesthetic Dermatology found the onset of gray hair happened on average in the late 30s for Asians, mid-40s for Blacks, and mid-30s for whites.
We need to lead the way for younger women. We need to stand up to patriarchy.
CUNY alum Darcy Miller says convincing more women to embrace their gray hair means standing up to decades of sidelining women as they age. After 3 decades in publishing, including as president of American Baby Group, her graduate thesis, Aging Out of the Spectrum of Cultural Visibility, examined how society devalues older women. She found today's multi-billion dollar industries of media, fashion and beauty, technology, even medicine, profit from convincing consumers they must resist aging. Dyeing hair is just one of the cheaper ways to do it.
Aging is more like a disease. It's something to be fought. It's not something to be embraced. It's something to stave off.
When we see men who salt and pepper, they look more distinguished. They look better looking, right? And when women suddenly get a little gray, it's like, oh, I think you better get your hair colored. You know what I mean? It's just a double standard.
Lisa Lord is a hair cutter in New York. She fully embraced her grays and saw an uptick in customers' interest during the pandemic about it.
I do feel more of a pressure maybe to stay more stylish with my gray.
Another 2021 study, this one by the Crown Clinic in England, suggests why. In a survey of 1,000 people who were shown pictures of graying women and graying men, the women were judged to be 6 years older than they were. The men, just 3 years older. The survey also found 20% of men covered their grays, compared to 75% of women who do the same. Lord was one of them, and she says she won't go back.
I'm just having it feel more healthy, because I've been coloring my hair since I was 22 years old, and I'm 53 now. It has a certain glisten, and it looks real.
Mee-Seen Loong's white streak started as a gray one. Now in her 70s, she's an appraiser specializing in Chinese works of art. Choosing to show her streak decades ago aligned with her work.
I work with antiques, and in looking for something that is genuine, you would always look for the bit of patina that tells you that there's age in it, that you're authentic. For myself, I just thought it would be better if I could age gracefully.
It took her years, but she says she's often asked how it can be done sooner. Some advice from a colorist now, if you're thinking about starting your own journey after years of being hooked on hair dye.
The longer you've been having permanent gray coverage color on your hair, the longer it's going to take to transition you into a more gray blended look. You have to do it in phases, and it's going to take about 3-4 lifts, and you can't do them all right away because you'll burn the hair.
Loong's streak, offset by still dyeing most of her hair black, is a nod to her heritage.
In Asian mythology, if you had long white hair, you were a ghost. But I could not offend my friends, my relatives, my community by looking like a ghost, because it would be very bad luck for them.
Shafi also says cultural expectations in her community were so strong, an older friend on her own gray journey turned back.
She got set up on a date, sort of a long distance date. The date asked her to send a picture and looked stunned at the picture. The South Asian man who colored his hair told her that before he meets her, she needed to color her hair back.
Shafi says in the meantime, the compliments she gets make up for any silent stares, and she's had a few.
I really get stopped on the street all the time. I see women who don't say anything to me. I don't want this to sound like a sort of a vanity project. It really was a kind of a spiritual journey.
Perhaps learning to embrace one's age only comes with age. For Asian American Life, I'm Vivian Lee.
I'm Kyung Yoon. A new documentary sheds light on a Korean immigrant named Chol Soo Lee, who was wrongfully incarcerated in the 1970s, and the Pan-Asian movement for justice that was ignited.
San Francisco's Chinatown in the 1970s was riddled with violent street killings by feuding gangs.
Yip Yi Tak was gunned down execution style.
Shot from behind by a Chinese man in his early 20s.
There have been dozens of unsolved murders. And the mayor, Eliotto, was really, you know, getting pressure on the police.
So there are always going to be priorities. And right now I say the priority is Chinatown.
In June 1973, a 20-year-old Korean-American named Chol Soo Lee was entangled in San Francisco law enforcement's haste to make an arrest, racially profiled, picked out of a lineup, convicted, and sentenced to life in prison for a murder he didn't commit.
Chol Soo Lee is charged with murder.
The jury found Lee guilty and sentenced him to die in the gas chamber.
It's far from the campaign that I am on death row. Crimes to not commit.
I couldn't get the Chol Soo Lee story out of my head. We just decided we would dive in, that this story was too important to allow to stay buried in history, and that we needed to tell it anew.
Journalists Julie Ha and Eugene Yi are the co-directors of the documentary Free Chol Soo Lee, which was 6 years in the making and released this year. Through archival footage and new interviews, as well as readings of Chol Soo Lee's own words from his memoir, the film probes into the complexities of Lee's struggles and the unprecedented Pan-Asian grassroots movement that united to exonerate him.
You see these grandmothers, you see these young people with, you know, feathered locks and like this really very 70s gear, just kind of all together, all holding signs, all working in unison to sort of free Chol Soo Lee. So that's, there's something that was just so powerful about that.
We came across a newspaper article, and it said
it was the investigative reporting by K.W. Lee, a trailblazing Korean-American journalist, that sparked the creation of the Free Chol Soo Lee Defense Committee, which turned into a nationwide campaign to demand justice for Lee. Their efforts led to Lee's release from prison in March 1983, after having served nearly 10 years behind bars, four of them on death row.
And even though he was unconditionally grateful for the movement that freed him, that he had so many demons chasing him. And it was not just the 10 years of unjust incarceration. That would have been enough, really, to ruin a person's life. But it was beyond that. It was demons, you know, and scars from his very childhood. Coming to America at age 12 and being treated, you know, so poorly as an immigrant, you know, no support system, no family support, then being put in sort of the school to prison pipeline so easily before this wrongful incarceration.
Chol Soo Lee died in 2014 at the age of 62. The film follows the full arc of his life, including his struggles and stumbles after being released from prison, as well as his efforts to use his voice to speak up for justice.
For too long a time, Asians have been on the subject of racial injustice in the history of America. I think this is time Asian community came forth and said, enough is enough.
Really, the root of Chol Soo's life is so much of what you face when you are an immigrant, when you are a person of color, and when you are poor, and how much you have to fight through just to survive in America. And when things go wrong, just how incredibly badly it could go.
In the rise of hate crimes against Asian Americans today, the filmmakers hope people will be inspired by Chol Soo Lee's legacy, which demonstrates the power of collective resistance.
The filmmakers hope that their documentary will help to establish the story of Chol Soo Lee, not only as an Asian American story, but as a part of American history for generations to come. I'm Kyung Yoon for Asian American Life.
What do Bruce Lee, Jackie Chan, and Mulan have in common? Well, they all practice martial arts. And recently, I spoke with one Korean-American college student who's proving herself to be the next Karate Kid.
For 20-year-old Haley Ra, martial arts has always been a part of her life.
My earliest memory is even before my family moved out to Rochester. It was in LA. At that time, my father, he learned under his uncle. So it was at that uncle's dojang, that's the taekwondo school. And it's just me and my brothers like putting on the chest protector, like running around and play kicking and fighting with each other.
Haley was recently featured in this CUNYverse story. She's a fourth degree black belt in taekwondo, a type of martial arts which in Korean means the way of the hands and feet. And for Haley, she specializes in a form known as pumse.
Pumse is a pattern of movements. You learn it like as a white belt from the very beginning. I describe it to our students as kind of like a planned out fight sequence. You know, you're practicing how to execute your blocks and your strikes.
What makes Taekwondo special for Haley is being able to do it with her family. Her two brothers, mother and father, also practice the sport, and coincidentally are all black belts themselves. It is her family's shared love for the sport that inspired Haley to put out her own rendition of the Cheat on Me I Dare You TikTok, a trend where people show off members of their family.
I saw that and I was like, I could put a spin on this. I could do it with my family. Like, yeah, like we're not like 6'5" and like ripped, but we are intimidating in a different way.
Together, the Ra family founded Agape Black Belt Center, a taekwondo school serving the nearby Pittsford area.
Hey guys, today I'm gonna teach you how to do tornado kick.
Haley's ability to lead by example is what her family says allowed her to succeed as a martial arts instructor.
When I am not able to be out on the mat, teaching a class, she would step in and she would take charge at a young age of like 10, 11. It was times like that where she would step up and, I'll never forget that.
And so when in-person instruction was put on hold during the pandemic, they stepped up and began offering classes over Zoom, teaching Taekwondo to their students online.
Having virtual Taekwondo was super important for us because we want them to still connect and know that we're here for them. They also have a community outside of their immediate family, which even though they don't see us every day, it's like we're here.
With the pandemic also came an increase in attacks on Asian American women. Many, as a result, enrolled in martial arts. And despite the circumstances, Ra says it's empowering to see more female students.
Recently, there has been a bigger enrollment with female students in our adult class, in our teen and adult class, which I think is really awesome. As a female martial arts practitioner, I love seeing other ladies on the mat.
Nearly 15 years and counting, Haley says she is grateful for everything Taekwondo has given her, including the people she's met along the way.
I feel like the Taekwondo community is really small, but it's really tight-knit. So it in itself has given me an extension of my own family.
And for those who may be interested in Taekwondo, Haley encourages others to give it a chance.
Biggest advice is it's for everyone and anyone can do it. You do it in your own capacity and you do your best. You know, we're all doing this to improve ourselves and strengthen each other. So it's never of a like, you need to be at this level. It's you do what you can and we're gonna get better together. So if you wanna do Taekwondo, do it.
For Asian American Life, I'm Michael Tamsuriamit.
I'm here in Elmhurst, Queens at the second annual Burmese American Street Fair. I'm wearing a traditional tindine from the Karen ethnic group from that country. The Burmese American community are here today to celebrate, but also bring attention to the civil war happening in Myanmar.
Their celebration and resistance at the second annual Burmese American Street Fair in Elmhurst, Queens.
I would say this is the heart of the Burmese American community in Queens, or possibly in New York City.
And New York State has the fifth largest Burmese American population in the U.S., according to the Pew Research Center. The vast majority of Burmese Americans in New York City live in this neighborhood, says Mo Chan, one of the event's coordinators.
One of the major ethnics in Myanmar.
There are more than 100 ethnic groups in Myanmar, including Kachin, Karen, and Rohingya. Some are represented here, and virtually all are united in bringing attention and aid to the crisis in Myanmar. Since the military coup in February 2021, close to 1,300 people have been killed in Myanmar, including 125 children, according to a monitoring group. This summer, Myanmar's military junta executed four political dissidents, including the Burmese rapper Pyo Ziat Daw, known as Nitric Acid. Chan is also tracking Myanmar's military atrocities on this website.
And they could, they are basically fear-mongering. They are trying to scare the general population by sending everyone a message that they can kill. But guess what? Our people are not free. And that is why they are here today. That is why we are coming together. That is why we are going to continue to support the people back home.
Chan says his organization will be sending aid to those in need in Myanmar. Many of the Burmese food vendors here are chipping in.
Most of the people over here, most of the tents, selling either they're selling food or selling clothing, whatever that they sell, they're invited to sell here. We don't charge them anything. However, whatever that they sell, they end up donating us whatever they receive.
Beyond the annual street fair, Burmese cuisine can be had at Little Myanmar in the Lower East Side, where Baruch College student Yunyatinang and her family are dishing out food for thought.
Dilum Yamai is my family's restaurant. We sell authentic Burmese food that's also halal. We have a lot of different kinds of customers who have some or a lot of knowledge of Burma. Some people, they just pass by and they just come and try, so they don't know anything at all. And then afterwards, they really like the food. So then they will talk to us about it and we'll explain.
For Yoon's mom, Tita Jo, each homemade dish is served with a little piece of Myanmar and some hope that the crisis in their home country gains more attention here in the U.S.
A lot of people dying, innocent people dying, most children, pregnant women, old, elder, they kill all kind of people in Myanmar, Yangon, other state, a lot of place, people are not happy and they are living in with this
anxiety
and then scared. Mm-hmm. So we live in the here, but we always with the, our Burmese people who suffering from this military.
For Asian American Life, I'm Rainer Ramirez.
That's our show for now. Be sure to visit the Charles P. Sifton Gallery and check out Photographic Justice, a tribute to Corky Lee. And next month, I'll have an in-depth report on the push to teach Asian American history in the classrooms, including right here in New York City. And don't forget to follow us on Facebook, Instagram, and TikTok at Asian American Life. I'm Ernabelle DeMillo. We'll see you next time.